As news stories emerged early in 2020, the impending scale of the pandemic started to become all too clear. This historic time of crisis demanded bold action at every level of Colorado State University. As the magnitude of the events came into focus, CSU researchers were well prepared to apply their scientific knowledge and innovative land-grant spirit to the challenge of a lifetime.
What do we know about the virus? What do we know about disease transmission? What do we know about epidemiology? And how can we put that into solving this problem?
For over 150 years, Colorado State University has brought critical knowledge to bear on the most significant problems of the time. This program explores amazing stories of passion, dedication, empathy, and understanding from the people on the front lines of COVID research. People who stepped outside of their day-to-day lives of discovery to realize that their scientific knowledge and practical, innovative solutions were desperately needed. Leading up to the pandemic, CSU had made recent investments that enabled unique agility. These included a new vector research building, advanced disease diagnostics, and vaccine platforms to provide medical solutions.
It's kind of interesting because we do think about this stuff all the time.
Rebecca Kading and Greg Dean are leading researchers and faculty from CSU's microbiology, immunology, and pathology department. From early on, the pandemic drew their concern.
You just start seeing that epidemic curve and like, oh my gosh. And you're just thinking about the, you know, interconnectivity of our world and, you know, how easily things can move.
We know the potential for the virus to jump and spread, but until you see it with your own eyes, it's hard to imagine how devastating it could be.
And I think it's been an opportunity to kind of build some interdisciplinary teams around a common threat and a common problem that we all have, you know, bring different expertise to bring to the table.
Yeah, there's sort of a traditional narrative that academics aren't that agile, but I think that went out the window when you look at how the response has gone here. And I love it because here we are at a land-grant university, and we are delivering on that mission right now.
For many universities, the pandemic would be a first experience in managing a widespread disease outbreak. Not so at Colorado State. Our work has spanned the globe to fight against ever-increasing infectious disease outbreaks. As the virus swept the planet and quarantines went into effect, the CSU research community went to work.
This was an incredibly serious problem.
Ray Goodrich and Lindsay Hartson worked to remove pathogens from blood using transfusions. This technology can also deactivate the coronavirus so vaccines can be developed.
I think we knew right away we had the technology to inactivate the virus, and we were coming up with, okay, what are the plans? Let's make it a priority. How do we start moving forward?
What's unique about the process that we're using is we're using a different approach to kill it. We're not using traditional chemicals which have issues with them in terms of safety. We're doing it by a photochemical method that's very selective in action at the nucleic acid level.
Hey, we've developed this amazing framework, these capabilities to do this. How do we start planning for what's coming? Because we know this won't be the last time this comes around, and can we do it better?
We're training the next generation of investigators and researchers, and those are going to be the folks who help in the next situation, because I think it would be naive to believe that things like this will never happen again.
As we look beyond this immediate crisis, CSU researchers are exploring new threats that may lie just over the horizon.
So I think that's always on the back of our mind, is trying to understand how these pathogens actually emerge, like in a wet market.
Dick Bowen and Angela Bosco-Louth have used space in the biosafety labs to create a virtual wet market where disease transmissions across species can be studied safely.
The struggle that we have is that it's always much easier to be reactive than to be proactive. So one of our goals is not only to try to determine as much as we can about this current virus and this current pandemic, but also to help build a bit of a model system for how we could inform how to prevent such a thing happening.
We are very interested in natural transmission. And so one thing that we've been working on is what we call artificial ecosystem work, where we take a room in our BSL-3 laboratory, populate it with multiple species that you might see in the real world, and then look at how transmission among those different species and within a species occurs.
And I hope, if nothing else, this pandemic gives the whole world a bit more of an idea of how readily zoonotic pathogens can turn into something like this.
Governor Polis declared Colorado State University a leader in the state's response.
I think one of the elements of that is the sort of CSU culture of just get up and do it.
Heather Pidcoke, as the university's chief medical officer, was and remains on the front lines of coordinating those efforts.
It's really where my passion lies, which is that whole idea of taking a scientific finding or a technological capability and figuring out real world problems that need that and seeing the magic that happens when you're able to bring people who are passionate and knowledgeable together to focus on a single problem. It's kind of like the Manhattan Project approach to science.
It was clear as the virus spread that the most basic protections were needed, from sanitizers to personal protective equipment. CSU researchers were ready to pivot from their usual projects to do whatever they could to help.
There was hand sanitizer shortage, PPE shortage, disinfectant shortage, and disinfectant confusion.
Karen Dobos and Lon Kendall worked to disinfect PPE and produce huge amounts of hand sanitizer for use across the university and the community.
Most of our work is just doing the daily care of animals here at CSU. That requires a substantial amount of protective clothing.
For the hand sanitizer, you know, we readily recognized that we did not have the capacity to continue to meet the demand at CSU and the neighboring community. So we reached out to some community partners, specifically the Gilded Goat and Copper Muse Distillery, and then to take over the mixing and large volume fill for hand sanitizer.
One of the first jobs CSU was asked to perform by the state of Colorado was to test all of the masks that came into the state from international suppliers.
And there was a virtual wild west of mask purchasing and mask supply going on across the world.
John Volkens and Kristen LaRange work in an aerosol emissions lab at the university's Powerhouse campus. They managed, in a week, to duplicate the official U.S. testing regimen used to certify masks.
So a lot of the work that we were doing before is actually pretty similar in some ways to what we've been doing for masks. We were fortunate that all of those same tools we could apply to the mask testing that we've been doing this last year.
Yeah, there's only actually one federal laboratory in the country that can certify a mask as an N95. But fortunately, that laboratory publishes their methods on how they test masks. We put together the equipment and the facilities to reproduce those federal test protocols to support the state.
We would get a call from somebody down in Denver saying the state troopers have a shipment of masks. They will be at your door in an hour and we need results tomorrow.
We are helping people make decisions where lives are at stake. And that makes our work extremely stressful, but also extremely rewarding.
As the virus spread in early spring, it became clear that our most at-risk populations were in senior care and those caring for them.
This is going to be devastating to this population.
In partnership with the state, Greg Ebel, Nicole Earhart, and Christy Pabalonia helped to mobilize the veterinary diagnostic lab to save lives in senior care facilities.
We didn't know if asymptomatic people were infectious to other people, and we were able to show that indeed they were. And that if we could isolate them and remove them from the workforce, we could begin to mitigate outbreaks.
You know, in my lab, we do surveillance testing for West Nile virus all summer long, and it's not really that hard to do. So why is there this problem? And it seemed like an opportunity where we could, you know, help make a difference in this area.
So after we worked through some of the logistics, and we worked with really great partners at the CSU Health Network who run a human testing CLIA laboratory, we were able to get up and running.
Well, I mean, I think it was instrumental in getting the state to be serious about testing in nursing homes and staff in nursing homes.
we've been really proud of the work we've done there, and then just felt a lot of satisfaction in working in our team here at the Vet Diagnostic Laboratories.
The fact that people understood and they rallied to the charge and were so responsive to me is probably the thing that moves me the most.
As the summer unfolded, CSU researchers began to prepare for students returning for the fall semester.
We understood that this data is an early warning system.
This meant getting a large-scale testing program up and running that could protect the health and well-being of the CSU campus.
And I think at the beginning of the fall semester, it was what made the difference between us being able to stay open and not.
Susan DeLong and Carol Willis worked to set up wastewater testing of all the residence halls on campus.
I do the sewers, and Carol does the molecular biology.
Because I had this instrument, digital PCR machine, was just sitting there. Nobody was using it because we were all locked down. The connection was made with the wastewater testing, and we ended up using it for that.
My student team gets started at 6:30 in the morning so that they can go to all of the different manholes around campus and deliver those samples to Carol's lab around noon.
From there, they'll be processing, extracting out the RNA, and they're usually ready to set up the digital PCR around 5.
So it's just a little more than 24 hours after my students go out that we have data in the hands of decision makers. But it's not without a lot of people working long hours, getting up early and staying late.
Our scientists helped lead the campus through a safe fall semester with one of the nation's highest face-to-face campus experiences.
Being able to test both wastewater and large-scale testing of individuals on campus with an easily collectible saliva sample rather than those nasal swabs really helped with our compliance as well.
Rushika Pereira developed drugs to fight infections, and Mark Zabel worked to create the saliva screening process.
And CSU was one of the first universities around the world to be able to start work on this because we had this amazing biosafety level 3 infrastructure.
And that really gave us a jump start on researching this.
I decided to help with testing drugs against SARS coronavirus. So we were approached by companies from all around the world because they couldn't find a facility that was able to test their drugs.
My lab volunteered to jump in and start developing a novel pooled testing strategy that allows us to test thousands of samples every day. And I do believe that that really resulted in our ability to remain open during the pandemic.
Other researchers helped by studying our mobility.
Everyone was immensely concerned about exposing others.
Bailey Fosdick and Jude Bayhem analyzed mountains of data about where we went and how that related to transmission.
When we're analyzing this mobility data and trying to have an understanding of how it's contributing to virus transmission or lack thereof, we're also just trying to understand what are the pressures on people already?
You know, it's beyond just the research. I mean, we are really using it to try to understand how we might design policies or testing strategies that account for that.
CSU often focuses on finding practical solutions across boundaries. In this case, between engineering and the arts.
There should be somebody on this campus who can help us with this issue of aerosol production and wind instruments and singing.
Dan Goble and Kristen Fiedak used an aerosol exposure chamber to find ways for artists to return to performing while keeping everyone safe.
So what we've been doing in our project is we recruit musicians, actors, singers, and we bring them into our facility so that we can run an experiment where we have them do their performing arts and we measure using our aerosol instruments, those bioaerosols.
This has been a project that exemplifies what interdisciplinary work at CSU truly is. There is an artistic side to science and there's a scientific side to the arts. And we're really finding that as we work together as a team.
As we emerge from this historic pandemic crisis, many stories will be told. The researchers, faculty and staff at Colorado State University have been writing their stories every day, delivering immediate results while also laying down essential foundations for future threat responses. Their heroic efforts will continue to make impacts for years to come, from Colorado to around the globe.